kind of prefer to sit, so we're just seeing if there's a stool. Is that all right? Yeah? If there isn't a stool, I'll just take my shoes off and start. Okay, I'll take my shoes off and start. Right. This is a story about women hidden in history. And as a novelist, I get about 100,000 words to bring it to life, but I've got less than 50 now. So I'm going to use a few images to help you. Look at this. This serene-looking place is in the city of Ferrara in northern Italy. That tree is a cherry tree, and the legend is in the city that when it blooms, spring has truly arrived. But for the story I'm about to tell you, that tree didn't exist, because what you are looking at 5 centuries ago was the entrance to both a great estate and a place of great pain and incarceration. The architecture, I think, gives it away. Not just in this place in Ferrara, but all over the city. And not just all over the city, but all over Italy. All over Italy during the period of the Renaissance, there were hundreds and thousands of convents in which hundreds and thousands of women were put when they were 13 or 14 years of age and did not come out. So as well as the beauty that we think of when we visit convents now in history, you also have to think about the isolation, the indoctrination, and the incarceration. The convent that I've spent 3 years trying to bring up in my imagination is the setting for a third of a trilogy of books set in the Italian Renaissance. And for the minute I moved into Italian Renaissance history, I knew I was going to have to come to nuns because they're everywhere. Let me tell you some statistics which are going to make your eyes water. By the end of the 16th century, it was so expensive to marry your daughters off, such was the price of wedding dowries, that most good families could only afford to marry off one daughter. The rest had to be married because they couldn't be left alone being sexually potentially active, so they were married to Jesus Christ. It goes without saying that all of those women who entered convents believed in God, right? There is no other game in town during this period. But it also goes to say that not very many of them necessarily had vocations. So what about all the others? Who were they? What did they do? How did they cope? Well, there were, of course, the rejects, the kind of unmarriageables, the girls that were born with cleft palates or with limps or with too many fingers or too many toes or number of birth defects, or there were the kind of genetic disorders, or there was the sweet little girl of 8 or 10 who got smallpox and had been destined for a husband but was so disfigured that she had to be hidden away. And there were the more subtle stuff. There was the depression. There was the psychosis. We now know that Galileo had 2 illegitimate daughters, put them both into convents, and the elder one had to go in to look after the second one, who suffered from melancholy. So those were the damaged goods. But there were also some who were too troublesome, some who were too fast as opposed to too slow, some who just were the accidents in the family. The church, of course, really couldn't care less. The cries of injustice, the cries of abuse, they're not listening to. Some things in history remain absolutely constant. Women were, at this time, of course, considered to be spiritually and biologically inferior. They're the source of all temptation. Eve does the tempting, Adam gives in, but Eve is always the problem, right? And so the church is not interested in the stories of these women. They cease to be individuals, they become nuns. So the only records that the church keeps is not of their lives, but of their deaths. And they're all remarkably similar. She died a true virgin. She was a pure bride of Christ. She expired like an angel after communion. And my favorite, she looked after the sick, those with the stench of sores which she kissed, and so contracted the illness of which she died. But if you start digging deeper into the archives, into court records, into tranches of letters, all those bits of sort of personal serendipity of history that have started to come to the surface recently, then you start to hear other voices kind of slipping out from between the bricks in the wall. This is a 15th century poem. My mother wanted me to become a nun to fatten the dowry of my sister, and so to obey my mother, I became one. Yet the first night I spent in my cell, I heard my lover's voice down below. I rushed down and tried to open the door, but the mother abbess caught me. Tell me, little sister, she said, do you have a fever or are you in love? Or this 16th century letter to the bishop. Many of us are shut up against our will and deprived of all contact with the outside world. Living with such strictness and abandoned by everyone, we have only hell in this world and the next. Or this, which is an extract from Galileo's daughter writing to her father. I hope to be excused for dashing off my last letters so randomly, father, but I was truly half beside myself in terror by our novice mistress, who, overpowered by those moods of hers, has tried twice to kill herself. The first time she struck her head and face against the ground with such force that she became monstrously deformed. The second time she stabbed herself 13 times, 2 wounds in the throat, 2 in the stomach, and the rest in the abdomen. She is now tied on her bed, albeit with the same delirium, and we continue to live in fear of some new outburst. The 3 voices I've given you, along with hundreds of others, are actually new to history. For centuries, we have been living with a history of the grand tradition: great men, great kings, great queens, great battles, the rise of democracy. But new history, the rise of feminism, the rise of gender studies, the rise of a whole series of things, have actually changed what we think of the past to show us something new. And what we have discovered is that actually there was a great deal going on in these convents. There were, for instance, all kinds of rebels, right? Now, by definition, you're not going to get out once you get in, because getting out is social death. Your family will disown you. But there are ways of getting other people in. So if you study the court records of the period, you'll start to find that there are really rather a number of mother superiors who have children, some of them actually still in the convent with them. You'll discover a taste of 2 young Venetian nuns who dig a tunnel under the storeroom to let in their lovers, and they only get discovered when one gets pregnant. When they drain the well of a convent that's closing, they find a cache of tiny little bones. And I think my favorite one is that a gardener comes into one convent in Bologna in March and leaves again in October. There is almost a kind of smell of sex around these convent walls. There are a lot of stories of young men prowling around them, getting convicted trying to scale the walls, or getting the young women to come out and throw down things upon them. Sex clearly existed, but it was not the only thing that existed. And in some ways, of course, that's what you'd expect. Needless to say, men loved the idea of women in convents. And one of the most powerful pieces of early Christian pornography is written at exactly this time, with a whole scene which takes place in a convent, which involves priests, monks, and a glass dildo. I should add, having thought about this a lot, and I've been in a convent for a while now, I think that may have been the imagination of the male pornographer. Because actually other things were happening which in some ways were more transgressive. There were some ways in which women inside could do a whole series of stuff that they weren't allowed to do outside. Think about your life as a woman outside at this time. You're married at 13 and 14. You basically become a breeding cow. You're going to go on to have 14, 15 children. You may well die in childbirth. You may well bury a number of your own children. You may well contract syphilis, which is ripe in Italy during this period, from husbands who have a very different version of what the moral code of marriage is to you. But inside, you get to do stuff that you're not allowed to do outside. So abbesses have the power to not only run a small estate, which has to economically work, they then have the money to commission new pieces of architecture, to commission great works of art. They are, in effect, Renaissance patrons. Or you get women who run a dispensary, who actually can make up medicines, look after the people inside the convent. Or you get women who are scholars, women who can write treatises about religious texts. You get women who can illustrate manuscripts. There's not a single woman in the life of Vasari's artists. But inside these convents, there are women who are illustrating and even actually getting their hands on the wall, decorating altars, decorating convents. Paolo Uccello's daughter at 16 grows up in her father's workshop. We know she's painting pictures that he's been commissioned to do in Florence, and she becomes a Carmelite nun. And if you were good at writing, then convents were incredible places. Because as we now know, there were huge numbers of women writing plays, which they were then performing on feast days and convent days, all of the parts played by the women, men parts as well as female parts, dressing up, dancing, and with subjects, although they were religious, were not always talking about religion. I have a friend with whom I'm working on a performance about nuns who has just discovered a manuscript which actually talks about how nuns deal with sexual abstinence. And there are three characters in this. The first is sexual appetite, which is a man. That is unheard of. Sexual appetite is always a woman in this period. The second is played by a woman, which is reason. And the third person who basically makes the decision is someone called free will. In the middle of a convent, at the time of the Counter-Reformation, you have a philosophic argument going on written by women. It is really quite amazing. And the plays are then samizdatted and sent around, okay? And finally, if you could play an instrument or you had a voice, then the convent was as good as any conservatoire you could go to. We should be hearing music now. These women were incarcerated, partly to keep them off the streets, but partly also to kind of build up the spiritual credit of their city, right? So they basically breathed in all the evil air of what was going on and turned it out as the oxygen of intercession with God through prayers and through music. And nowhere was that more important than in the public chapel where people came to listen to them behind the grills singing. What we now know is that not only did women performers become famous, so much so that groups of young men would come and hover by the grill to listen to these choirs of virgin angels, but there were women adapting and composing music, so adapting palestrina for female voices. There were women playing all kinds of instruments, and there were actually women composers. You are listening to a composition by a Venetian woman composer, and you are listening to it sung by a group of women, historians and musicians now, who've made it their business to reproduce the repertoire to show how rich it is. But there's one final area of fulfillment in a convent, and you probably can already imagine what it is. It's going to sound simple, but actually I think it's really quite complex. Because while there were a few men in the convent, like father confessors, really they were basically entirely same sex, without men, except there was one man who was present all the time for them. Jesus Christ was absolutely everywhere in convents. Think about a world without advertising, without huge amounts of visual display, with a starkness of architecture, and this man everywhere. We know his face extremely well. Actually, they really thought they knew what Christ looked like, right? They had a record of a centurion's letter which described it. It turns out to be a forgery. But every single person, this face was more famous than David Beckham's face, right? Everybody knew it. This is actually a line drawing from the 18th century, but it absolutely sums up what Christ looked like. So this was his face, which they knew, better than any man they knew in their life. But also, of course, there was his body. What we are talking about now is a period of history, of course, where, but unlike any other time, artists know how to create the human body like flesh and blood, right? So gone are the two-dimensional versions of Christ that you don't recognize as a real person. And here you have it, a hunky, chunky, physical Christ, more often than not, almost naked, right? So there are these women in an atmosphere of spirituality with this male form, and clearly the relationship between the spirit and the eroticism is very powerful. But it's more complex than you might immediately think as you think about it. Of course, they're encouraged at one level to think of him as flesh and blood. He's their husband. They're married. They come in on a wedding ceremony, right? Ecstatic writings talk about Christ coming into them as a lover. But the man who comes into their dreams or their cells in their fantasies is really a rather different man from the ones outside the convent. And the next one. Outside the convent, these women are growing up in one of the most macho periods of history, right? Their fathers, their brothers, this is a bloody culture of violence and a sense of men strutting their stuff on the street. This is not a macho figure. This man is actually quite different and quite sensitive in a way that almost brings together the masculine and the feminine. I think there is an extraordinary ambiguity in the kind of feeling these women got about an image of Christ. This Christ is a man of sorrow, a man acquainted with grief, a man who has suffered, who understands suffering, a man who's been abused, a man who's been oppressed, a man who in many ways has had experience with which whom they can relate very well. And there is something about this male Christ in these convents, when you read the writings of this woman, which is about them almost not knowing whether or not to share his suffering or to relieve it, to nurture him or be nurtured, to love him or be loved by him. We are talking about an extraordinary period where women are basically going through sensory deprivation, right? They are living in cold places where they get up in the middle of the night at 2 o'clock to go to matins, right? Where when the candlelight is there, they'll see shadows dancing on the wall. There is no doubt that these women were having visions, right? We do not actually know what went on in the cells. We have accounts, often through male confessors, and we also have images. The most famous, I'm almost finished, the most famous is a male image. Next one, please. Bernini's Saint Teresa. Next one, please. Look at that face. Look at that face. A French aristocrat, on seeing this face, actually says, "If this is sexual ecstasy, then I have had it." Actually, I think what they experienced was weirder, more complex, richer, more painful than that. I have no idea what actually went on in that cell, but I do know that it was something that we have yet to totally understand. And I do know that while historians can make versions of it, maybe with any luck, I as a novelist can try and get slightly deeper into it. Thanks very much.